I guess right off the bat, I'd like to know where are you with the GM Ingersoll strike?
We're stuck in the mud. There's no question the whole issue was about job security. 2 years ago, we were the sole supplier for the Chevy Terrain and the Equinox. We built over 400,000 vehicles a year. And this is the plant that is the best in the world, the most productive, build more cars with less people. So here we are today, 2 years later. The best we can build is about 190,000 vehicles. The Terrain is being built in Mexico. And GM has two plants in Mexico that can also build our Equinox. So this is really about ensuring Canadian jobs. It's about making sure there's not a straight migration of the high-tech jobs to Mexico. This is the poster child of what's wrong with NAFTA, to be honest with you. Like, even when you're the best in the world, we can't compete with workers in Mexico making $2 an hour.
Right, so this lends itself to that conversation of what's been happening with the renegotiation with NAFTA. How do you keep Canadian jobs in Canada? You have an American president who wants to keep American jobs in the United States. How do you do that? How do you keep those manufacturing jobs from going south of the border?
Well, look, I don't blame Donald Trump for arguing, by the way, that jobs should be brought to the United States because, look, workers in Canada, workers in the United States, frankly, workers in Mexico, all got left behind in the whole NAFTA agreement. This was nothing about workers. It was all about corporate greed. It was about movement of capital, free movement of capital. So look, in Canada, we closed 4 auto assembly plants. In the United States, they closed 10. In Mexico, they opened 8. They're opening 2 more. BMW is opening a plant in 2019 where they're gonna pay their employees $1.10 an hour. So the question becomes, Canada, in my argument, Canada and the United States should kind of join together to say, listen, Canada's problem is not the United States. The United States' problem is not Canada. The problem is the fact that they pay people two-fifths of nothing in Mexico. Mexico cheated for 23 years. 23 years they cheated, so we need to fix that.
So are you suggesting a bilateral agreement when you say it should be United States and Canada, a bilateral agreement as opposed to a trilateral agreement?
Look, I'm fine with a trilateral agreement as long as it's fair. You can't have workers in Mexico making 65 cents an hour minimum wage. You can't have workers in auto plants making $4 an hour on the high end, but on average $2 an hour. Look, they can never ever afford to buy the cars that they build. So there's something inherently wrong with the system. Like, why would Canada and the United States say, we're very comfortable surrendering all of our good paid manufacturing jobs to Mexico? So this is what triggered the whole NAFTA renegotiations. I'm pleased it's going on, it's about time. And there ought not to be a deal unless we fix the real problems as it relates to labor. So we've got, Canada has two problems. We've got the low labor wages in Mexico and we have the right to work states in the United States. Because what do the United States and Mexico have in common, the right to work states? Neither of them believe in free collective bargaining. The United States has two problems, the low wage rates in Mexico and themselves. So there's a lot of dynamics going on here right now in the NAFTA renegotiations. It's an opportunity to fix it. And I believe it will get fixed or else. Well, let me rephrase it. I'm not convinced it's going to get fixed. I think this thing is going to fall apart in December and it'll come together sometime prior to the U.S. primaries.
Mm-hmm. So perhaps we could be operating on, we've talked about this before here at the Financial Post, perhaps we could be operating on a skinny NAFTA, if you will. So some kind of a framework that will keep us operational until next year when we can reopen it and revisit some of these issues in greater detail.
Well, it could be, but even if NAFTA falls apart, there's a free trade deal between Canada and the United States. Will the U.S. blow that up? Could be. So there's already some rules in place, but I think one thing that the Canadian government and U.S. government both agree on is that we've got the short end of the stick because Mexico is really played with the deal. They found a way to wrestle the manufacturing jobs from Canada and the United States. And they did it by their Mexican industrial strategy, which really talks about yellow unions, it talks about protection agreements. Let me give you an example. 90% of the unionized workforce in Mexico belong to the CMT, which we called yellow unions. In other words, not a real union. In other words, there's no real unionization in Mexico except for the miners and a few other industries. But what they do, it's legitimized by the government, but they're corporate unions. So BMW, for example, the plant's not even opening for 2 years and their union has agreed to workers making $1.10 an hour. So it's a part of the Mexican industrial strategy. So here's how NAFTA is unfolding so far after the first three sessions. You've got Canada saying we want to elevate and raise the standard of living for Mexican workers. You got the United States saying we want to raise the standard of living for Mexican workers. You got the president of Mexico saying, no, no, I want to continue to ensure that my citizens, almost 50% live in poverty. I want to make sure they're exploited so that we can attract business investment. So the Mexican government has nothing to do with the citizens. It really is an arm for corporate, international corporations. So it's really about driving down wages. It's about suppressing people. It really is about exploitation. So it's a fascinating system that the president of Mexico is determined to keep his people in poverty.
You've had your ear to the ground. What are you hearing? What kind of progress are we making? Are we making any progress?
Well, look, we're making progress on some of the low-hanging fruit, the things that there was never a disagreement in the first place. So I'm expecting things are going to heat up significantly in Washington next week. I think we're going to start to deal with some of the real elephants in the room, auto, rules of origin, some of the major issues, ISDS, Chapter 20, the dispute mechanism. So I think we're going to start to have some discussions, but I don't believe this is going anywhere because the U.S. has taken some ridiculous positions. They're taking a Buy America position. In other words, they're going to control all the procurement infrastructure spending in the United States, but they want full access to all those programs in Canada and to Mexico.
Maybe that's all been posturing. Maybe ultimately the deals that are being really negotiated are approached with a little more, I guess, a more diplomatic approach, if you will, as opposed to that kind of, that rhetoric, that kind of inflammatory rhetoric.
Look, I know a little bit about negotiations. And the one thing you never do is insult the people you're dealing with. Because if you're being insulting and disrespectful, that means you have no intention of forming an agreement in the first place. So everything the United States is doing is saying that they're going to try to extract everything they can from Canada, everything they can from Mexico. They're going to run the gauntlet. We're going to come to a conclusion in December. It'll fall apart, and somehow it'll probably come together sometime before the U.S. primary. So, look, it's a pretty straightforward game. I understand it quite well. The U.S. will try to extract everything they can, put it in their back pocket, blow it up. They'll use that as the beginning position when we re-enter negotiations and try to extract more. But the problem that they've got is people really aren't foolish. Everybody understands this. I take a look at Steve Rahul. I met with him this morning for breakfast. He is one smart cookie. He's Canada's chief negotiator. Everybody understands what the play is here. People understand what's going on. So I believe that ultimately people are going to position themselves accordingly, based on what the U.S. is doing, and the U.S. is sending signal after signal after signal after signal that they don't want a deal, at least not in the short term. So why would we bargain with ourselves? This thing is unfolding very predictably. I'm not concerned. I'm not fooled. So we'll see what the end game looks like.